continue. I would assume until and unless somebody brings to my notice, I will keep talking, but there are slides till the end. So if you don't see something, do let me know. Yeah. Okay. And yes, we'll try and take a break because I do understand, although we are so enthusiastic to learn together, but it can be torturous as well to sit through 2 hours and try our best to gain something from it. So let's see what I can provide in terms of a break and change of stimuli that I could do. So as I've been, as you have been all aware that today we would spend the next 2 hours in understanding qualitative research methods. And as Archana had very rightly said, that when as researchers, we are always keen to understand as to which method should we use and why should we use a particular method, okay? So now in this whole journey that we are going to take to understand qualitative research methods, I would like to flag 4 important landmarks that we would like to reach in this 2 hours together. The first we would look at is what is qualitative research, and we would look at it from the 4 notions of qualitative inquiry. The 4 beliefs of qualitative inquiry or the 4 notions of qualitative inquiry. And we'll quickly look at 7 categories of crucial assumptions for qualitative inquiry. Yeah. So by looking at these 2 frameworks, it's assumed that we would have a substantial understanding, a common, and I'm sure all of you already are familiar with it, but the reason of going through this is that we arrive at a common understanding of this whole concept that is much debated and contested in the field of social science research. After looking at this, we would look at qualitative data collection methods and types, and you would smile, and as I was putting slides together, I was really wondering at the pre-PhD level, do we really need to talk about this? But you can be sure that the things that I assume that would be known, we would quickly, brush through them. And we would look at certain kinds of methods and techniques that are unique to qualitative research. The reason being, in qualitative research, the methods of data collection or analysis or anything with regard to methodology constitutes the concept of qualitative research. Okay, so that's where we would look at these different kinds of methods and types. And then we would look at certain reliability and validity issues and concerns in qualitative research, because very often that we hear people say, and even with public funding of qualitative research, it is a major area of criticism that it lacks reliability and validity. And if it does lack reliability and validity, then what really makes it as a scientific process of inquiry? And how do we enhance this entire process to make it a process that is valid, that is reliable, and something that we could term as scientific as well? Then we will look at the types. Now, probably it is here that I would break after the validity, reliability, and then we would quickly look at the types of qualitative research and overview of the different researches we will take. So I propose to take probably a particular area of research and see how the same area of research or the same kind of topic can be dealt with differently across different methods, but then what would be the distinguishing feature, though there is a lot of common between all the qualitative researches that we have at our disposal for use. Okay, so the first 3 I would take up in the first part, take a break, and then go on to the next part of it. At the end of this, I commit myself, and I would want you also to commit yourselves to the objective that we would all develop an appreciation for the method, the paradigm of qualitative research. I do not assure that all of us would learn exactly what it is to do a qualitative research, because as we would see through the session as it unfolds, that what we would probably get through this is an appreciation, and much of the skill comes in doing. Okay, so with this background and this what being the map that we are going to follow, I'd quickly now move on to the first question that I have. And for this first question, I would request you all to put the responses that you, whether it is A, B, or C, in the chat box. Yeah, whether A, B, or C, can you put this in the chat box for your response? So the question is, which of the following questions would qualify as a qualitative research question? Question one, what does it mean to have job satisfaction? B, what is the relationship between mental health and perceived sense of job satisfaction? And C, what is the difference in the perception of job satisfaction of teachers with teaching experience less than 10 years and above 10 years of age? Friends, I see that there are 90 plus people, and therefore I wouldn't proceed till I at least see 50 responses. I think fair enough for demand, right? Right now we are on 8, and I would want at least 50. So somebody could help me when we reach at least 50 or 55 to tell me that, look, this is what we, the, you know, ma'am, your deadline has been crossed.
Yes, ma'am, I'll do that.
Who's that, Usha? Usha, yeah, ma'am, can you also please also try and look along with me what were the most common responses? Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, I'll do that.
Only the first two, like the major would be this and second would be this.
All right, ma'am.
Usha ma'am, can you mute? I think somebody
and most of them have said A is the response which is most common. A few have said D. Of course, we are having some B's and C's also, but majority, ma'am, have said A.
Okay. Now, and that's great.
Then there are some responses.
Huh?
There are some responses which is like A, B, C, D also, but that's very few. Some have said all four also, ma'am.
Okay, all four. And yeah. And how many responses were there, Usha?
Ma'am, I'll just take a minute to do that because they were quickly coming in.
Okay. Yeah. As Dr. Usha tells us about the number of responses that have come in, and I could see that, and Dr. Usha has also told us that the response A seems to be the response that is much voted for.
Ma'am, nearly 45. And they're, but people are still giving their responses, ma'am.
Okay, great. Yes.
Going, it's reaching 50 now.
It's reaching 50.
Yeah.
Now, I would want one or two of you to only unmute yourself, the one who is answering, and the one who has answered A, one of you who have answered A, could quickly unmute yourself and say, why do you think A? Somebody who has answered A could quickly unmute yourself.
ma'am, we can see the correlates, like what you mean by job satisfaction. So you can understand their subjective view of the of job satisfaction rather than being in a objective.
Okay, who's that? May I know your name, please?
My name is Amit Shinde.
Okay, thanks Amit for that response. Okay, so he said that we could see a subjective view, no? That's what you said, right, Amit?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Okay. Okay, great. Somebody who has written A, B, C, D. Yes. Somebody who said A, B, C, D, would you like to unmute? There is nothing wrong or right. Yeah, so let's just share why we said that. Come on, okay, even if you've not written, you want to say, yeah.
Ma'am, I think Joyce Brito has said A, B, C, D. Yeah. And then we have Mrs. Pallavi also who has said all four.
Okay, so can I ask Joyce or Pallavi to say that, to unmute yourself?
Miss, I'm Pallavi.
Yeah.
I think these are subjective, all four, I feel. Means like it can change from the situation. Maybe from the city to rural area or whatever, wherever we are, each one can change. Mm-hmm. That's why I feel they are qualitative, all four.
Okay, okay. Yes, Shilpa has raised her hand, or is it an error?
Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
I would also like to add to what Pallavi said is that all these are it's not possible to measure them in the sense they are not quantities which you can measure like marks or something.
Okay, okay. But yet we measure, isn't it? Don't we measure job satisfaction with a tool?
Yes, ma'am, we do. But the tool would lend to it, but in terms of according to me, it is A and D, but now that I'm looking at it again, I feel that all the variables are very difficult to measure and okay. We cannot have like a very accurate measure for them. That's why I'm
okay. Okay.
It qualifies as quality.
Ma'am,
can I come in?
Yes. Can I share something?
Okay. Yeah, who's that?
Ma'am, myself, Fatima.
Yes, Fatima.
Ma'am, as per my thinking, the job satisfaction will be a different perspective depending on different individuals.
Okay.
So the measurable quantity, it's like you cannot have a definite measure that, okay, yeah, this is 100% job satisfaction. Because for me, even if I'm getting something very little, for me, it may be 100%.
Okay.
And yeah. Somebody who's getting too much also, they may find, I'm not satisfied.
Correct.
So that is why when we say that, what does it mean by to have job satisfaction? It is definitely a qualitative research question rather than a quantitative research question.
Okay, thank you.
And then, ma'am, can I come?
Hello. Yes, the next person.
Yeah, I am Parveen. I feel regardless of the topic, it is the data which dictates the methodology. If I decide to take an interview with people about the job their satisfaction and my data is verbal, then it is qualitative. But if I decide to use a tool and my data is numerical, then it is quantitative. So I think it is the data which dictates your methodology largely.
Okay. Yes, Parveen. Thank you. So we've got different perspectives to it. Some of you say that what cannot be measured with the tool, we should use it lends itself to qualitative. Somebody else said that it is the kind of method that would determine, like the kind of data would determine whether it is a quality, lends itself to qualitative research or so. But friends, that you would all agree with me that over the years, even constructs like job satisfaction, happiness, well-being have been quantified and have been measured. Yes? So we have gone in this process of measuring this, though you may say that may lend itself. Now, in this whole purpose of this slide was to start thinking as to what then would lend itself more to qualitative research. Is it relationship finding? Is it to compare and find differences? Is it to get an overview of the meaning of certain terms? And probably I would say that though that is, I'm not saying that there is a particular right answer, but I would also probably lean towards A as an option, because it would probably give us an understanding of a construct, understanding of a concept. And see, then when we understand that, we would understand that in relation to, so that is an umbrella term probably I would have looked at, though having options A, B, C, D too are not wrong. But my objective of asking you this question is totally met, as I still see we all are at different places in our understanding of qualitative research. Yeah, for some of us, qualitative research means where there is no numbers. For some of us, qualitative search means things that, you know, depending on how I got data, it is whether it is qualitative or quantitative. For some, it is subjective understanding is qualitative research, the first response that we got. So we see we are all having different kinds of words or constructs that we are clinging to. Okay, just give me a minute. My battery running low. Okay, so this is what we understand by this whole aspect of call being our understanding of qualitative research. I would take one example of a which many of the books on qualitative research has given this example of one of the early topics that lent itself to qualitative research. And that topic was Howard Becker, 1963, where he tried to answer the question of how does one become a marijuana user? Marijuana user, that is a drug. And when he tried to answer this question, he answered it using a methodology that was then adopted as an example of what qualitative research is actually about. Okay, so firstly, he tried to understand as to how do the people who use marijuana as a drug learn how to smoke, and how does it produce the so-called correct effects. He was able to discover the effects associated with the usage of this particular drug. And thirdly, he found that learning to savor the feelings related to its consumption was another area of insight that he got for answering the question as to how does one become a marijuana user. Okay, so how do they use it to get the correct effects? If they get the correct effects, how discover the effects that is associated with the drug? And thirdly, how do they then savor would be another word, is delight, to enjoy, to relish the feelings associated with it. And because the strength of connection between how I start enjoying to savor the feelings related to its consumption would determine whether I would become the user of this drug, how long and to what intensity I would use it. Yeah. This is like any other addiction. A small addiction of even talking about X to Y and Y to Z. Correct? We need to learn that skill of talking to X about Y and to Y about X without getting caught. Then we need to then discover what are the great, you know, advantages of doing this. How does that help you to be in the good books of everybody? How does that help you to probably be the most popular person, or because people fear you so much, they will then start dealing with you very carefully and probably even giving you so-called respect. And then the longer I start enjoying that status I achieve because of trying the skill will determine how, whether I continue this as a habit or not. So this particular research had brought in findings, though, which was related to drug use, had brought in findings for human behavior and how does one get into certain forms of addictions of behavior. And this, again, being, as I said, one of the most talked about researches by Howard Becker in 1963, it got more and more refined with time. Okay, and because it got more and more refined with time, it evolved as a process of research. So let's now move. So the question then arises to each one of us. What exactly is qualitative research? How can we evaluate whether the research is good or not? And how is qualitative research really different from quantitative research? For launching the first question, that is, what exactly is qualitative research? I would ask each of you to put three words that you associate with the word qualitative research in the chat box. For example, I'm taking the name of maybe Amit. If Amit has three words like subjective understanding, similarly, two other words that he could choose which qualify or contribute to the definition of qualitative research. Can you put that down? Okay, Joyce has put Lata, Shilpa. Okay, there have been quite a few responses. And of course, encouraging to see the different ways in which we are all thinking. Okay, so friends, as we see that each one of us are looking at the same construct so differently. At the same time, there are a lot of similarities in our thinking. But that itself is a good case for why qualitative research, because it really tells us as to how each one of us are viewing this complex world so differently, based on various social factors that contribute to our understanding. Okay. Usha, at least there must be at least 25 to 30 of them responded.
Yeah, ma'am, more than that.
More than that.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
So then, yeah, could you just tell me some main words?
Yes, ma'am. It is descriptive, explore possible reasons, allows free expression, non-numerical, subjective, again, non-numerical, descriptive, then interpretive, phenomenological, then tells about detailed study of the behavior of sample in natural setting, interactive information, non-numerical. I think non-numerical has come several times.
Several times, yeah.
Yes, yes. Subjective, again, experience, subjective, lot of data, attributes, questioning, subjective.
Okay. Verbal. So I think the next popular word would be subjective, right?
Yes,
non-numerical,
yes, ma'am.
And subjective.
Subjective, yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So we'll continue then. So now let's look at this quickly. Yeah, I would like to take you through, according to Patrick Asper and Hugo Corte 2019, in their attempt to define qualitative research, let's see what are the kind of landmark moments in qualitative research they have attributed it. Okay, they say that the early beginnings of qualitative research lies with the founders of sociology. We know many of us who have a little exposure to sociology would find these words very familiar. It is Weber, Durkheim, Samuel. Okay, these are the early beginnings where you see traces of qualitative research can be attributed to that. We then see it was in 1963. And when was this marijuana drug research that we had talked about? Which year?
1963.
Correct. Okay, great. So you see that it was the first time in the American Sociological Review Journal, an American Journal of Sociology, that a qualitative research was reported. So it made its formal appearance in the academic circles as a methodology and an area of exploration in 1963 in the American Sociological Review and American Journal of Sociology. And the research is what we had already discussed about. Okay, we also then move on to see then later, it was in the 1970s that we see that till the 1970s that it did not have any prominent position in research discourses. In discussions on research, there was no prominent position being given. Now, this was when we are talking of the world history, okay? In India, probably we could trace it only as recent to maybe the late 1990s. But it is in the worldwide, it came to its, it surfaced as a methodology and got some prominence only post-1970s. And much of its prominence came because of the fact, okay, that it was used in order to capture and understand tacit information. Now, what is tacit information? Those of you who come from management and education backgrounds, what is tacit information? What is unique about tacit information?
Intangible.
Intangible, okay. Why intangible?
You can't say from where you have learned it. It could be, you know, you get a complete picture, but you can't pinpoint.
So it's okay, very so it intangible. Is intermingled with? Anybody else? Intermingled with what? Where here, which component is high? Is it the content that plays an emphasis? Or as she said, it's intangible. You cannot lay your hands on it. Correctly said.
Is it experience, ma'am?
Yes, it is experience-based information. Okay, so therefore, like, I think it was Archana in the first voice, correct? Who was the first one who said tacit?
Ma'am, Parveen.
Parveen. Sorry, I now got so used to Archana's voice, maybe because of the introduction. Yeah. So you see that it is intangible. It is mingled deeply with the kind of experience that one has. And therefore, we say it is something that comes due to a constant interaction with the kind of learnings that we are engaging with. And friends, it was in post-World War II that practice was tacit. The situation was so unique. On all the different structures of which society stood seemed to have crumbled. whether it was economic, whether it was social, whether it is cultural. Okay, a new social order was struggling to be formed. And one could not rely on past information, which was, what is opposite of tacit? What is opposite of tacit?
Stated, explicit.
Pardon?
Stated.
Which is stated.
Yes, correct. Stated. Any other word?
Right. Explicit, ma'am. Explicit.
So explicit stated knowledge would not hold true. I want to, friends, pause now and tell you that today where we are standing is going to be similar to post-World War II situation. It is this pandemic is going to change the social order where explicit knowledge alone and stated knowledge alone is not going to help us in being able to recover and understand, give meaning to our processes, whether in the field of education or social life at large. Our ways of interacting with people, our new socio-economic order that is going to be created, our educational systems of how we are going to deal with the learners, a society that is going to be so fractured and overburdened with so much of bitterness, hate, disbelief, disillusionment, where there will be so many political ideologies tearing one another apart. We are in such a situation today where we will have to find meaning from day-to-day experience. It is from day-to-day interaction and experience we will have to redefine education. It is going to be a society where there will be so many who are widowed, orphans, loss of loved ones, family structures broken, and no amount of definitions of what your learning and teaching should be is going to hold good. But I would encourage each one of us in the system of education to use these tacit experiences to convert it in new forms of knowledge, to redefine the space of education. And that's where this topic today comes, qualitative research. How are you going to capture experiences of what you are doing and what works, and where should we really look up to, what we should lead learners to in a very unique and differentiated way. And therefore, friends, that it was post-World War II when society was restructuring itself, the practice was tacit, which led to the criticism. Okay, and there we started using quantitative methods, psychological tools. We found disillusionment with psychological tools. Then we moved on to understand how do we capture this tacit knowledge? How do we then use qualitative ways of looking at the world and its meaning and experiences? And initially, when qualitative research began, it began with an understanding of only comparing qualitative with quantitative. Even today, if I ask you what is qualitative research, you will say what is not in quantitative research alone. So, matlab idhar jo nahi hai, wo idhar aana chahiye. What saddens me is in paper reading sessions, un log kehte hai ye qualitative research hai kyunki isme numbers nahi hai. Maine interview liya, isliye ye qualitative ban gaya hai. Par interview lete hue bhi, you can be still predominantly doing quantitative research. Data verbal hone se bhi tum quantitative research kar sakte. To fir qualitative kab ban sakta hai?
It so depends. Ma'am, sorry, yes. Sorry to interrupt, ma'am, but then that becomes mixed method, na ma'am?
No, 1 minute. So when I'm understanding qualitative research as a unique method of inquiry, understanding that it need not be only compared with quantitative and contrasted with quantitative, but having it as a unique method of itself, I can use qualitative research. Mixed method research or qualitative research or quantitative research will come from the philosophical stance that I subscribe to. Will come from my philosophical stance and the kind of weightage I'm giving to which philosophical questions and understandings regarding who is the learner, who is the researcher, who is the one who's being researched, what exactly is reality, what do I want to do with this particular research, and that the answers to these questions will determine how whether it is quantitative to qualitative. I can use quantitative and qualitative data and yet not have it as a mixed method research because I am predominantly using it for a purpose of non-generalization. I am using it for a purpose of deeper understanding in order to get certain aspects of the phenomena out in terms of understanding and discovery rather than answering certain research hypotheses alone. So it all depends on the framework and the position I take as a researcher. Let me give you one more example before I move to the next slide. In an evaluation research study, okay, now, for example, a recent evaluation research I conducted for MIPA, where you all know, friends, with the NEP, school teachers have been asked to do many online courses on the Diksha portal. One of the courses is LEAD program for leaders. You have different PSLM program, etc. Now, when I'm evaluating it, I evaluate it based on different kinds of interviews, focus group discussions, the kind of reflection on the analysis of the answers and reflective diaries of the people. At the same time, I am using the pretest and post-test scores to compare it. Okay, but if I am only using it as a method in order to check the effectiveness of this program with predominant weightage given only to see the movements that they made and therefore, how can I say this course is successful or not successful and henceforth whether this course should be launched or not launched, I am not using mixed method. I may use it as a way of analysis. Or I may use mixed data sources of data. Okay, but I may predominantly want to choose to yet make it in the evaluation research framework a quantitative research design. Where I would, through focus group discussions, etc. Now see, for example, the chat responses. If I keep only giving numbers to those chat responses and say majority answered this in the beginning, majority answered this in the end, though they were words and not numbers, I am still doing a quantitative analysis for generalization. I am not concerned about the voices that answered differently. Yeah, so there again, that's why I'm saying it differs from why the purpose of the entire research and how I am navigating through data, who is the researcher, the researched reality, methods, proximity of the methods, and we'll go further to those four notions to understand how should we differ in our understandings. Some glimpse, I hope I have answered to somebody who asked me the question. So it is mixed method.
Yes, ma'am.
I know it's not totally answered, but at least a beginning to start thinking. Okay. So this is, looking at it, therefore, remember, we stopped here. It was initially understood between quantitative and qualitative. Therefore, I urge my friends who are more and more dwelling into qualitative and mixed method to go beyond looking at qualitative research method as a contrast. दैट मीन्स ये क्वांटिटेटिव मतलब ये क्वालिटेटिव, ये क्वालिटेटिव मतलब ये क्वांटिटेटिव होगा. ओके, मूव बियॉन्ड वाई बिकॉज एज वी विल सी थ्रू दिस, इफ यू सी द इयर्स दैट आई हैव पुट हियर, ओके, इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू फाइंड अ डेफिनेशन फॉर क्वालिटेटिव रिसर्च. And most of your articles, if you look at to understand what is qualitative research as well, talks of it with, you know, to get a comprehensive definition is very difficult. And so what do they talk? And they define it in terms of social and temporal context. So when we are giving importance to social and temporal, that means the situation in which the event is happening, and we want to understand an occurrence based on that social and the timing when it is happening, then we made some of them are defining it as qualitative research, because a research that gives emphasis to social and temporal context. We move on to see, we'll see that in specific, some people have defined it is because it is a research that is specific to place and institution. Therefore, it is not generalizable. So they say qualitative research is specific. Some say it is interpretive. Now, all these words, friends, contribute to the definition of qualitative research. Interpretive matlab, meaning making. When we are giving a meaning to what we are saying. For some, as we began, it is subjective meaning matlab, qualitative research. When we look at this multi-method, which said Denson and Lincoln in 98, and we see Silverman who says it is multi-method. You cannot say that I am using only one method. Sometimes that also can become qualitative research. Okay, and Silverman and Flink in 2007 and 2005 respectively said, qualitative research is an approach. An approach that is unique, an approach that has its own specific belief systems, methodology, analysis, ways of reporting that are unique, which may or may not occur in the other forms of research. Okay, so these are the words that contribute to qualitative research. So friends, many of you, I was happy, have already written these words. But I want to encourage you then. So you may ask, "Fir isme kya naya hai?" Ki no one attribute or two attributes can define this method of research. But let's understand that all these words, along with our worldview, that's why I put the researcher here. Okay, along with the researcher's worldviews, with the researchers' beliefs, with the researchers' understandings, contribute to the definition of qualitative research. Can I move from this? Anything that you would want to ask? Can we move further or anything?
Dear participants, if you have questions,
yeah.
For ma'am, you may just unmute yourself and ask ma'am.
But ma'am, the basically, if you see qualitative is more on words, and I would say more related to the experiences only, whatever type of qualitative you take, it revolves around the experiences part only, na, ma'am?
Correct.
In it short, revolves... it is the experience, and that is what we believe in qualitative, that each individual has different experiences, which we try to understand them. In yes. short.
Yeah, yeah. Correct. If I'm not wrong, is this voice Lubna's voice?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. See, I'm actually here like visually challenged because I don't want to put that screen up and see the speakers and all. So therefore, okay, yeah, what you rightly said, Lubna, it is predominantly experience-based, but we cannot negate, for example, I may want to use in qualitative research even certain tools and use some quantity. So what all that I'm trying to say is, let's not reduce it to numbers and words contrast. Let's expand, and within that domain itself, try and use even different creative ways of capturing experience. don't limit it to the understanding of only of words and no words, of numbers and no numbers. And wherever words are there, it not necessary would capture an experience. For example, if I were to ask to do an analysis recently I did of a program that we have, the university has started its human values cell, and we had done an evaluation research of an ESIP program, student induction program that we conducted online. So we tried in the chat box, whatever questions, opinions, expressions of the students to analyze. Okay, now that was a subpart of evaluating pre-test and post-test scores. Okay, so because I was understanding the experiences, it did not make it fully qualitative. It became a way of visually representing understanding expression as expressed by participants, or understanding expressions of participants over 8 days, 5 hours a day. But that did not really give me an in-depth understanding of the, I didn't do justice to the experience of individual participants. But I used an analysis technique of qualitative data analysis as a technique under the belief or the major paradigm of quantitative research.
So, ma'am, you can say that it is a belief, it is the emotions, the feelings, all these things comprising of qualitative research.
Yes. Yes. The method, the belief, you know, everything comprising. Don't take one aspect and single it out. That's
so,
it.
Ma'am, is it that the abstract ideas, like in quantitative, we value it with numbers and other things. But here it is more in an abstract way that we are talking about. We are trying to gather the data. Correct. Is it that, ma'am?
Yeah, we are evolving and understanding from...
Which is intangible, basically.
Correct. And we are evolving based on the view of the researched student. Matlab, from the participant's view, when I evolve a definition. Like somebody rightly said, job satisfaction for people will vary. For some people, probably even after 2 lakhs, you will have no job satisfaction. And for somebody, even after 10,000, they will have job satisfaction. But therefore, what makes job satisfaction according to the participants under study, when I evolve an understanding of that word, even the most commonly used word, from the lens of the participant, it is qualitative research. Correct?
Yes, got it, ma'am.
Got it. Okay. Now let's see how...
So ma'am, 1 minute. Yeah. I just have a question.
Yeah.
So ma'am, can I say that means even if I'm doing a quantitative research, I can define a variable taking into consideration the view of the participants which are under study?
Yeah, you can.
By using the qualitative method?
Yes, you can.
Like I want to understand what is their opinion about a classroom climate.
Okay.
So I can elicit it out from the participants, from my own sample under study, and then define the variable and then proceed to the quantitative aspect.
You may not define. Now that depends. If you're doing a quantitative research, you can get participants. You may have your tool already established. Okay. Or you may use this first in order to construct your tool, or you may have your process all done and your research is nearing completion, but you are wanting to give more understanding and depth to it. So you will then call students for a focus group discussion, or you may do a detailed interview in order to understand their ideas of classroom climate and then try and see a correlation between the two, or substantiate your findings. So there will be multiple ways of doing this.
Yes.
But you will have to decide in the beginning whether you are doing, what is your overarching framework? Okay? Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Your name, please?
Lata, ma'am. Lata Murali.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? Can we go ahead? So let's look at 4 notions of qualitative inquiry. I would encourage you to, as and when a question comes up, put it in the chat box. Then after they have substantial questions, Dr. Usha or somebody can help me by pausing me and saying, ma'am, there are 4 questions. Would you want to answer it?
All right, ma'am. I shall do that, ma'am.
Yeah. So if some of you feel comfortable unmuting and asking, do it. For some of you, you just want to put the question in the chat box so that you don't forget, go ahead with that as well. Okay. Let's look at this framework for understanding the four notions of qualitative inquiry. Okay, Aspers and Korda 2019 in his article on understanding the notions of qualitative inquiry says there are four defining features. That is distinctness, process, improved understanding, and closeness. Now let's try and understand what does this actually mean. Okay, you've taken a note of these four words, the distinctness, the process, the closeness, and improved understanding. Okay, let's now move on. What makes, so when you are defining qualitative research, you need to, these would be helpful markers. What makes this research distinct? What does this stand for? What definition of research has it contributed to the community of scholars? Okay, firstly, what makes this research distinct? What does it stand for? And what then makes it, how have you contributed, or how has this definition of qualitative research contributed to the existing understanding of research to the community of scholars? So here I want to raise the point that I think somebody had brought up before, that in qualitative research, you said that it is the method that determines the research, whether it is qualitative or not. And I would say it is not that. We begin by answering these questions. Okay, so next, so this is what we would go with. As a process, how does one move between theory and evidence? That is analysis and generating material. The question is about how one moves between theory and evidence. How do I analyze the kind of data that I have, the theory that exists, and how do I generate new material and knowledge? How does one become deeply familiar to them? To whom? To the participants, to the phenomena. Sometimes may not be participants, but to the phenomena. How do I become deeply engaged with them? How does one distill the first order and second order constructs? See, job satisfaction is a big term, but you will also see that there is a number of sub-constructs that will compose job satisfaction. Do you agree with me on this or no? Would there be sub-constructs to job satisfaction?
Ma'am, what do you mean by sub-construct?
Yeah, for example, defining stress or maybe job, let's take job satisfaction, I would have a sub-construct of a sense of achievement. I would have a sub-construct which all these constructs which are contributing to job satisfaction will come as sub-constructs, which helps me move and build the definition of job satisfaction.
So basically the meaning that I understand, or I am trying from my point of view, what does the job satisfaction mean? That is the sub-construct.
Correct. Yeah,
so my basically it is theory. It is the factors or the pointers that makes job satisfaction my Correct. As a concept.
Correct. And that okay, would be got you. From theory.
Yes.
Yeah. So that is where we would be careful to see that my understanding has to be rooted and anchored in some theoretical stance, whether a psychological theory, a management theory, or a philosophical theory. But we would have to look at these different theories to contribute to what makes job satisfaction. Correct?
Ma'am, do you mean that it should be aligned with the theory and my way?
Alignment should be, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And we should therefore, in chapter one of any research, we encourage people to write about the theoretical background. Because this does not come only from intuition alone. It also has to be rooted in some kind of theoretical construct, theoretical understandings that have already been established, and you can add new, but you cannot be intuitive alone in the process of research. Okay, then what then are these different oscillations? What are these different oscillations we are talking of? We are talking of oscillations at every regard, with movements that we are making from theory to practice, from data to analysis and analysis to data, from distancing to closeness in terms of relationships and closeness to distancing. We are constantly making movements when I'm interacting with the research. For example, at some point of time, I need to become close to the participants and to the phenomena and immerse myself. But at the time of writing and structuring, I need to move back and distance myself to try and consolidate, to try and understand and reflect, to look at it from a distant view. Therefore, they say we move from etic to emic and emic to etic. Please take note of these words. Etic and emic. Etic is an outsider's perspective to a phenomena. If I want to study Diet Panvel, when I study it from the perspective of being a researcher from the Department of Education, I may have certain questions in my mind, research questions, and therefore I become an outsider. Correct? As I go into the situation and keep interacting with people, I become involved with them, and therefore I culturally start absorbing what they are doing and saying, and my questions now change. I've made new kinds of thoughts are coming, new kinds of assumptions are coming, new kinds of questions are coming, and therefore I now use the word emic issues. And I move from an etic, an outsider, to an insider. But at the time later, when I'm in a sense of disillusionment, time of confusion, time when I'm meaning making, I distance myself and try to objectively look at all that is going through. And therefore, again, so it's a constant oscillation. There is an oscillation taking place between analysis and collection and analysis. I collect some amount of data. For example, from the chats today, if I collect, if you are putting, helping me to convert this to a research, you may put all your thoughts about each concept, keep keying in your understanding. And then if I would try and understand how you have progressively moved from minute one, R1 to the R3 in terms of different responses, number of people putting, etc. But and then I would hold a discussion with you. After some time, so I'm analyzing that, then decide that this is insufficient or I need more or I need clarification, I again come to data collection. May not be through the session, I may call you up separately. Then I may come back to my data and put the two together. Then again, I may decide that I need still something else, so I may use another form of a data collection method. Clear? So there is constant oscillations taking place. So the process of qualitative research is important to make it a distinct research.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am Usha here. So there is a question by Joyce Brito. She says that ethnography studies will be purely descriptive.
Pardon? Can you repeat?
Yeah. Ethnographic studies will be purely descriptive in nature?
Ethnographic studies is one method of qualitative research which will uphold all these principles. Which should not, it will, it should uphold these principles, but whether it is descriptive, I've rarely seen this word descriptive associated, but any qualitative research is descriptive, It is explanatory and it is interpretive. Descriptive, quantitative research. Now I'm going to the primitive ways of defining. Quantitative is also is descriptive. But here, how is it different? Because it doesn't restrict itself to describing alone. It then moves on to giving meaning, interpretation as well. Okay, next. I hope I have answered that question.
Yes, ma'am. She said, yes.
Okay.
Ma'am, there are no more questions now.
Okay, then we'll move ahead. So, friends, see, by taking this word process, I have attempted to capture an entire, the nuances of going about this. Okay? And I hope, and as I told you in the beginning itself claimed, I'm not saying this full comprehensive, but I'm just trying to give you an appreciation and a beginning of a journey. How do I get close to reality? It's another aspect that defines qualitative. And you need to ask yourself for this being a qualitative researcher. I think these four notions of qualitative inquiry also holds good for quantitative. Okay. But it is written in the context of qualitative. So I'm writing it. How my question is that would define qualitative research is what am I doing to get to reality? So what am I doing to get to reality and what reality is? I have not really answered the question, how do I get close to reality? Because the assumption for a qualitative researcher is you will never understand reality in its totality. And reality exists. It comes from the philosophical thought of an existential thinker, as well as we would see idealism also contributing here, that reality is not absolute. Reality is based on what it by the one who is going through the experience. So when you said, when I may say, and I often struggled with this in the beginning years of my career, okay, I would say that maine kya kiya wo student ko itna bura manne ke liye, maine to bas itna hi bola time pe submission karo. But student said that I was very rude. Okay, and it takes me, and I keep saying that what that is jhoot. I was not rude. But then friends, as we evolve, as we grow in our understanding, we understand that for me also the truth is that what I say is also truth and what she says is also truth, because reality depends on the way one perceives. So for her, given her state of mind and her context and her social situations, she, in the way she has interpreted, is also true. Okay, so every situation, when I'm giving meaning, I need to understand that I can only get close to reality, but I may never be able to understand reality. But how close can I get will be determined by the process of data collection, analysis, and those different oscillations that I spoke about earlier. Okay, next. It is all about improved understanding. Okay, how does one move from explanation to understanding? Therefore, when I said ethnography does not restrict itself to description, it moves from description to explanation to interpretation. Okay, these are all different things, so that it brings about understanding. Understanding about what? Understanding about that previous thing of what reality really is in the eyes of the participants. And how does one communicate reality? I think I'm far, far behind time. Okay. And how does one communicate also will determine qualitative research. Qualitative research, therefore, is not an objective form of while writing. Remember, in quantitative research, we write the researcher, the sample was according to the researcher. Research is about, it's all in the third person. But when I write a qualitative research, I write it in the first person subjective tense. Because it is a reflection of my understanding and the participant's understanding. And therefore, I cannot distance myself from that. Therefore, I don't use third person language. Even the way I communicate and write is different. The language is only one aspect of it. So while defining qualitative research for you, for all of us, you need to ask, is our understanding of qualitative research different? But yet, how does it integrate elements of research? How does it move from explanation to understanding research? And how does one communicate the understandings of research? Therefore, you will see these are any steps that one needs to do. First, what is the nature of research? That's why I said it does not determine on the method or data or my expertise alone, but what is the nature of research? Where do I want to position the relative participants? Where do I want to direct my gaze? My gaze is a stare. The word gaze is a stare. You know this word, I love it when it is used with newborn babies. They say that a newborn baby just gazes at their mother or the caregiver, where you do not know what they are staring at, but when you hold them in their arm, in your arms, they stare at your face. And they say this is called as the love gaze of the baby, where they are trying to understand the world through you. And friends, qualitative research is all about this. Where I look and look and look at the world that I am trying to understand. And with every form of stimuli that I receive, I am weaving a meaning about that world in my mind. Okay, next, what is the purpose of the research will determine. This will determine not only the meaning of qualitative, it determines the method of research that I'm going to follow. Is it an MA research, PhD research? Is it funded by a government agency? Therefore, what would they want to see happening in that research? Who am I doing this research for? Is the audience of the study? Therefore, that will alter the kind of research questions and the depths that I am going to. To what extent can I exercise agency? Agency is nothing but to what extent am I able to motivate myself to use all my capacities to act? And of course, my own political position. Political, not whether I'm for Congress or BJP or TMC or so and so. My political position with regard to my understanding of power in relation to people and situation around me. And we all have a political position that we have already taken. We only need to discover it. But friends, that determines research and data analysis. It determines kind of research. It determines the technique of analysis, the way of writing. It determines what I'm writing and how I'm writing as well. Okay, is there anything? Anyone wants to ask something pressing or can we move? I'm not going into the detail of this.
Ma'am, just one question. What types of research come under qualitative method?
I'll be touching that in the later part. Yeah? Okay. But before we go to that, as somebody said, and I think most of us as lay people understand this as this way, we all have secondary we all have methods of collecting data. Now, for example, if the HA college decides through their capacity building program to convert this into a research paper in as their contribution to the SDG 4 goal. What is the SDG, Sustainable Development Goal 4? What does it talk about? Any guesses? It talks about building a just, equitable, and sustainable society, and how education is a tool. And we all know that India is committed to the realization of the Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. If HA College wants to analyze this particular series of sessions and how it has contributed and made its small contribution to the Sustainable Development goal number 4 in particular, then they would probably then look at, even if it is an afterthought now, they may probably look at what kind of data they had used, collections that they had done, what data is available, and then they may want to convert it into a study. So sometimes, friends, we may move this way, but that is not the way for academic research. When it comes to your PhD or your master's or MPhil level research, etc. But in day-to-day life, when we weave research, sometimes you may, after doing things, say, why not convert this into, because I've learned so much through this, why can't I do this? Okay, and therefore, you may probably want to do these unique methods like conduct focus groups, which are more characteristic to qualitative research. So again, I'm repeating, questionnaires in qualitative research can be used. Rating scales can be used. You can use different kinds of quantitative measures. You may want to choose ANOVA also as one of the ways of analyzing to give you understanding. But that cannot be the singular method. But if you are predominantly trying to make meaning as per the certain frameworks to understand how capacity has been built in the lives of the people, 90 people who have attended your seminar, and using a framework where every possible aspect of capacity building is touched, you would be able, you want to do a qualitative research where this may be a small aspect that strengthens the research. So may not even go all the way to use it as a mixed method, but just as a sub, it helps in strengthening. You may also use observations, interviews. But what I want to bring to your attention is focus group discussions, life histories and narrative inquiries, historical analysis, film, videos, and photography, interaction analysis, and other unobtrusive measures. What are other unobtrusive measures? Without going deeply into the lives of individual people, without intruding into their privacy, without unknowingly, if they display a particular behavior, you are able to, with their permission, capture that behavior and use it as data, could be termed as an unobtrusive measure. Okay, so I would encourage you, apart from restricting yourself to observation and in-depth interview, move to options like these. Move through options like films, videos, and photography. Another beautiful way I would have done, giving just throwing ideas, that if I were to ask you at the end of my session, at least I would want you to send me one photograph or one picture that you think depicts qualitative research. Okay, that would be another way or a tool of using photography in a qualitative research analysis for a qualitative research design. So I could take your pretest if you all had anything. I could take your quiz responses. I could take your discussions. questions that you have asked, I could also give the ask you that tomorrow before the session, send one photograph each that you would want to give for if this photograph depicts qualitative research. Okay, and that also could be another way. I'm just trying to help you explore different. Now, due to lack of time, I will not explain these different ways, and I would quickly move to even with regard to interaction analysis, okay, validity and reliability in qualitative research. Conventional methods, we have validity, reliability, and empirical generalizability. However, in qualitative research, such terms are not directly applied because of different frameworks, different sample approaches, different size, and different goal of qualitative data. For these reasons, we don't use these two, three words, but then what do we then do? We use words of rigor, credibility, and relevance. Friends, remember these important words, rigor, credibility, and relevance. Okay, so rigor is nothing but the thoroughness and the appropriateness of the use of the research method. So what method I used? Did I use it thoroughly and appropriately? This credibility, was it meaningfully used? Did it well represent the findings? And is it relevant to the kind of findings that I use? The methods, okay, that I followed. So these are the words that we use in qualitative research. Some more, two more. The transferability is another criteria that I use, or the relevance. How useful are these findings to the context and the phenomena of the study? And whether I have used triangulation, that is a comprehensive approach of at least more than three ways, multiple theories, multiple data, multiple methods, that is aimed at mutual confirmation of measures for validating findings, and whether all these five, that is these three plus these two, contribute to the purpose that it is to relate to different kinds of data and to enhance validity of the findings. Any question till here before I move to the methods?
Ma'am, there is a question which says that, can you name some theories used in qualitative research?
Yeah, I would definitely. Now that depends construct to construct. For example, as I gave you, if the HA wants to use this capacity building program as a research framework, I may want to use the OESD framework for capacity building. If I want to use motivation or for online teaching and success of online teaching, I may want to use certain theories of distance, online distance education theory, where they talked about the three different criteria of social presence, cognitive presence, and pedagogical presence in online learning. So that may be a theory that I would inform, I would use to inform me about my study. So depends on the construct. I would look for how different people have tried to explain that construct and use it as a framework for me to be able to get my themes, get my understandings in place.
Ma'am, that was all. There's just one question.
Okay. Can I then quickly move on then? Yeah, I assume by now that we all have understood what qualitative research is, its process, its unique ways of collecting data. And I'm very sorry I couldn't go into detail because I took up a lot of time in the beginning trying to get a common understanding and reaching a common base. So we've seen that there are unique ways of collecting data. We've also seen that reliability and validity is not termed in terms of certain numbers and procedures, but we use different terms, and those different terms was credibility, which was relevance, transferability, then rigor, Then it was triangulation. These are all terms with which we describe these particular forms of the processes for data. Now, all this is used, friends, in every type of qualitative research. Okay, they will have only the extent and weightage will vary from type to type. So let's look at what are these different types. The first type is the grounded theory. Now, this is no hierarchy. Huh? This is only for convenience. So it's not that, you know, this is the type and then it needs to be and C. So this is just for convenience sake, I'm saying. So it is the grounded theory research design. I won't go into the details of doing this.
But the screen is not moving.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Let me stop and restart, maybe because I... Now?
Yes, ma'am, it is moving.
Okay. So the grounded theory type, when my purpose is to develop a theory, when do I want to, what is a theory first? Can we quickly put in the chat box or unmute? Those of you who can put in the chat box, great. Those who want to mute, great. Only one response. What is the theory? A system of ideas, great. An idea based on a phenomena, okay. Yes, a belief, okay. Little different than a belief, can we take that as, yes. Yeah, but it has to be a belief, but what more? It is thinking, okay. Hypothesis, not really. It is generalizations, okay, all together. Oh, glad. Is it Nishi Kumar from Xavier's? Okay. An idea tested and experimented. Okay, great. Okay. So I think we are coming to different words on this and very well stated. So for it to become a theory, I'm using the most base definition, that is the most lowest form of understanding, is when different facts are put together and we try to give meaning and connection to the different facts, it becomes a theory. When different facts or different, if you want to use the words constructs or whatever, when we are putting them together and connecting that with an explanation or joining those different facts together, we are making, it is forming a theory. Of course, a theory then becomes somebody's belief. A theory is something that should be verifiable. A theory is something that somebody or the other should hold it true. So to that extent, it becomes a truth. So in education, friends, we, you said, give examples of theory. We didn't, in B.Ed, M.Ed, etc., we have also studied Maslow's theory of hierarchy of needs, correct? We have studied Piaget's theory in psychology. In management, we have studied different theories of organizational development. We have whose theory, give me one or two management theory names. Anybody can unmute and tell me? Any theory in management that you have learned?
Herzberg's theory of motivation.
Excellent. Herzberg's theory of motivation. Great. Okay.
And it's that's theory like, X and theory Y.
Yes. Excellent. Yes.
Maslow's theory.
Very good. Very good.
Z theory.
Yes. Yes. So we see that these are all theories. So that means they have tried to explain different things, giving connections. These are things that we see, we can relate to reality, compare and see it holds good. It becomes a belief that it is true. And so all that all of you have said contribute to the definition of theory. I can see the chat, anything different, anybody else? Before we proceed, Taylor Scientific Management Theory, yes. And it starts with a question, very well said. Okay, now, can I, being a researcher, develop a theory? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. For example, people have talked, Schirmer's theory is there for beliefs, correct? We have the theory with regard to epistemological beliefs. We have theories with regard to even reflections. Whose theory is reflection in action and reflection on action? They have given those two things, two aspects. Yeah, so now there are different theories explaining how reflection takes place in my students, how students move in understanding and belief. As a teacher, teaching at the Department of Education, I want to study whether these theories are not only I use these theories, but see how my unique students of 7, 10, 20, I'm using these single and double digits, not because I'm bringing the sample down, but because nowadays in MED you have those many few students. So whether my 20 students or my 7 students who are able to, how are they moving in the journey of reflection? So what will I do, friends? I will take the support of existing theories. People have already explained how reflection has taken place. But my unique 7 students, my unique 20 students in part 1 and part 2, they will contribute to new knowledge and they may prove or evolve a totally new theory because they come from different social temporal contexts. And therefore, based on the life journey of my students, I can come up with a theory of movements in reflection for postgraduate students in education. Restricting it to the journey of my students. But it can be informative for other students, who are other teachers who want to build an understanding of their own students' journey. Similarly, for how my students have evolved, how have their identity evolved? Do you agree with me that even though they are in MED level, their identity is still in the forming stage?
Yes.
My identity also is in the formation stage.
Yes.
Yes. So my journey of identity formation in 2021, can I develop a theory of that as well?
Yes.
Means probably collectively many of us at the department, how have we evolved in this 2021, a unique year, and how identity, what forces have contributed and what kinds of identities have surfaced and what kinds of identity attributes have been sacrificed in this entire year of this journey. Yeah, I want to make a theory. I use grounded theory. Okay.
But ma'am, how do we know that the theory that we have evolved is right or it is on the right lines or whatever it is?
So therefore, I will always align that to
laptop charging ho gayi
hai. Mute.
Na use nahi karungi, beech mein use. Nikalti hu, band karti.
Please mute yourselves. Okay. Yeah. So here what happens is, how do I know it's right? It depends on the process that I used, the theoretical backings that I have used, and the criteria of relevance, rigor, triangulation, etc. and wherein it takes care of rectifying objectivity and subjectivity issues in the theory in the process of research itself. And no amount of, what will we say, when do I stop taking data, where do I, these comes again questions that will be addressed in analysis of data, where we were talking of data saturation when you know nothing new is coming from, where I use more than three methods, where I use strong theoretical foundations, when I see that it is relevant to the findings, when I see a correlation between, when I have participant triangulation as well in that. These are all small checks that I adopt in my process. Okay. So this being ground, so I want to develop a theory, I will use grounded theory. Next, all this procedure is the same, but my purpose is to study human experiences from life stories. To study human experiences from life stories. In your class of 50 for B.Ed., for me 20 in part 1 and 7 in part 2, you will agree with me that at least 10% of our class have gone through a COVID crisis. Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Can I now want to capture these stories, not to tell what the crisis did for in terms of physical health and mental health, etc., but how has these narrations of COVID crisis, people who have gone through a COVID crisis, they are narrations of coping with education at the Department of Education, at the H.J. College of Education, at the BTTC College of Education. So through life stories, which I will, as a skillful researcher, maneuver and weave the physical, emotional, social trauma to educational practices, processes that they are actively engaged in, and cause a marriage of these two ideas in order to understand the experience from life stories of individuals, it is narrative research. Clear? Let's take ethnography. When I want to describe cultures, for example, I want to describe the culture of M.Ed. Part 1 and M.Ed. Part 2. Can that be a culture to study at the Department of Education?
Yes.
So, though it evolved from sociology and studying tribal social cultures, but today we consider even any social group as having its own culture and all characteristics of culture being fulfilled, then I will do an ethnography study. Next, when I want to understand the social orders people use to make sense of the world, through analyzing their accounts and descriptions of their day-to-day experiences. Means, how have they used the social orders? For example, of a social order is, how have they used their family, the different social agencies, the different kinds of political agencies, the different kinds of resources available in their day-to-day lives as individuals in order to make sense of their day-to-day experience. For example, if I want to study how individual people who have survived the bomb blast in Syria, okay, how are they using the different kinds of social orders to make sense of their own world of living as Palestinians in a war-stricken zone, I would use ethno-methodology because I'm capturing their day-to-day experiences intertwined with the social order to get sense and accounts of descriptions.
So, ma'am, this fourth one would be more from a political perspective?
More from a socio-political perspective.
Socio-political, right?
Yes, socio-political perspective.
I mean, historical perspective bhi aa jayega na usme.
Yes, it could be historical. But remember, in qualitative research, we do not go too far behind to term it as a historical, though historical artifacts are used. What are artifacts? Distinguish between a historical research and an artifact. Historical research is when the the phenomena is long past the individual. When there are survivors that may or may not be existing from that situation. Then I may use historical research as a method. But when I'm using artifacts in ethnomethodology, I may probably use their diaries, their WhatsApp chats. I may use newspapers, photographs that they have taken. Now, these may be historical artifacts, that is, articles that contribute to understanding, but may not be using historical research method. Because usually qualitative research engages with lived, L-I-V-E-D experiences of the people in the present.
So, ma'am, in this history, when you say historical research and historical artifacts would be the primary and the secondary sources.
Correct. Of data.
Yes, yes.
Yes, that is. But when I, so those are sources of data. But when I, they sources give me certain articles or certain substantial things, may not be an article, even a piece of conversation, a tape of conversation, etc., becomes an artifact. The tape becomes the artifact. And the source probably will be the, whether it can be classified as secondary or this. But a good parallel that you have drawn. Great. Now, phenomenological research. When I am understanding the described lived experiences, people in the second lockdown situation, where they are not terming it as lockdown, okay, but in the second wave, their lived experiences as teachers is very different. Often I ask myself, even as a mother, as a woman of a house, that remember in the first lockdown, we managed 6 months without helpers at home. But in the second lockdown, when the helper is not there for 15 days also, we feel we are washed out. What then was the difference? So as a teacher, if we can realize that there is a difference even here, imagine that how much could there be a difference if I only pause to reflect as a teacher, how am I different the first time I tried to teach and the second time now that I'm trying to teach? And what are these lived experiences that I'm trying to capture in the second, though I may have done a study in the first?
So, that ma'am, sorry, what is the difference between day-to-day experience and lived experience? Day-to-day experience is also our lived experience only that we share.
Correct. Okay, perfectly right. So, it is the lived experiences and day-to-day experiences are more or less the same. The minor line that I would use to differentiate between the two is lived experiences may probably not really restrict itself sometime to my own day-to-day experience alone with regard to the present that I am in. So there is a very fine line of difference that I would see in the two. Let me try and look for an example to describe this. Okay. So for example, when I am talking of based on your day-to-day experiences, which you have gone through on first-hand basis, as I used the word of the Palestinian life of children or people who have gone going through this terrible experience of the war and bombing, etc., by Israel. Okay, so here is when they, from their own lived experience becomes their day-to-day experience, but lived experience can be even beyond a day-to-day experience when it's captured over a period of time. For example, after maybe things come to normalcy. I'm capturing their day-to-day experiences. But through that day-to-day experiences, there have been also experiences that they have, they which will contribute to their memories over time because of not only their individually going through it, but even memories of what the society has gone through, people other than them have gone through, etc., would contribute to that lived experience. But more or less, it is the same. But I would enlarge it when I move to lived experiences.
For example, ma'am, do you mean you're trying to say that day-to-day experiences we may forget, may we may remember, but lived experiences are something which we, it's a memory, it sits in the long-term memory and we never forget. Is it that?
Yeah, it sits in the long-term and it could be contributed by experiences that I may have not gone through myself as well.
Okay, okay.
Ma'am, can I ask a question? So if yes. somebody decides to study the online learning experiences of students in the near future, where will it fall at now? At no methodology?
In future or now?
Maybe in future.
Okay. So now that we to define where it will fall, let's look at the objectives that we would come to in a few years from now. Okay. Bandukar. Okay, let's look at this with Rick. So what will differ? It would lend itself to all types, but will depend upon which is the main objective that I'm using. I'm going to take you now to little, give me few minutes before I take you to one topic and what will differentiate it across the different methods. Okay, let's look at evaluation research to determine the effectiveness of programs, plans, practices, curricula, etc., and to provide feedback. Like I told you, you have a program, you want to do that, you want to evaluate the effectiveness of this, you could use qualitative research. Even now, this form of research lies in the borderline between quantitative and qualitative. Okay, reason why we are saying it lies in the borderline, because it can be used as a quantitative method as well as a qualitative method. Okay, so but nevertheless, quantitative also offers itself to evaluation research. Okay, next we look at is, 1 minute, yeah, policy analysis to formulate and to evolve policies. This again could be a qualitative research predominantly. It is also termed as a method of qualitative research. Content analysis. For us, you, when I began as a student, I restricted my understanding to policy, to content analysis is to look at textbooks and analyze the content. But now I am looking at this with regard to content, even in terms of articles, journals, etc. Just give me a minute. This is an exam house call that I need to take. Yeah. Hello. Ah, madam, bola. Sorry. Yeah. So content analysis now, even if I want to study the definitions of or defining qualitative research through content analysis. I've seen a lovely article on that. So we look at different articles that are talking about qualitative research and then doing a content analysis of that and arriving at a comprehensive understanding of qualitative research. Content analysis is also done with regard to scripts, transcripts, etc., manuscripts, transcripts, articles, etc. We are able, and mostly in qualitative research, we use content analysis as a data analysis tool. Okay, so whatever research we are doing, we need to be conversant with content analysis and concept analysis because they facilitate data analysis. Okay, now with this, we also have historical to study in the past as one of, but we need to be very mindful while using this whole aspect of historical research. Now, before going into the details of ethnography and all that, I think much of us would know these details. I want to directly take you to this one slide where, look at this. Is the slide visible? It's a comparative thing.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay. Now look at this. You are asking which method to use for this. Rather, I would ask you, find out why you are doing this research. Have a broad research question and then decide which method.
Yes, ma'am.
Because the same research question can be answered differently and each method will give you a different product. Let's look at this. The research question is, if I'm using the word grounded theory and I want to, the broad area of my study is, how do women teachers cope with family responsibilities and engaging with online teaching and learning in the learning in higher education during the lockdown caused due to COVID-19? So broad area is what? Women teachers balancing their responsibilities between what? Online teaching and household other responsibilities. And we all have to belong to higher education. So we want to study how they are doing this. Okay. So we come up with the first research question. If we are doing it through grounded theory, our product will be, look at this, will be a theory regarding the basic social processes involved in coping with familial responsibilities and engaging with online teaching and learning culture and factors that might count for variations. The strategy that I would use for analyzing data probably would be the constant comparative analysis. But nevertheless, now since you have not done data analysis, look at the question and the product. So when I want a theory which will explain the basic social processes, connect them together, and how various factors are either helping or deteriorating or connecting these different social processes that are impacting the life of a woman teacher in the COVID-19 situation, I come up with a theory of that and use the grounded research theory. If I'm using the phenomenological study, I will ask the question, what is the lived experience of women teachers with family responsibilities and engaging with online teaching learning culture and higher education? And therefore, I would have descriptions of essential structure of balancing with family responsibilities and online teaching and learning during the lockdown. So here I had a theory. Here I have descriptions of what are the different structures that have helped. When I'm using an ethnography study, I could take teachers belonging to a different, to a particular unique culture, okay? And how has engagement in teaching and learning managed in different social contexts during the lockdown? Do you agree socioeconomic context would vary in the way, determine the way I adjust to the teaching learning during lockdown?
Yes, ma'am.
Areas of stay would matter. Kind of help and nuclear families and joint families would matter. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Areas in Mumbai would matter.
Yes, ma'am.
So therefore, when I'm looking at this, therefore, based on culture as a lens, even religion may play a role in the culture.
Yes, ma'am.
Even, yes, people from different religions also, their ways of coping and doing things and living also determines. Therefore, I can do an ethnographic study. when I want to capture lived story in the form of stories. Remember, in narrative research, I have to put down stories. Stories with the time, you know, the important plot, the introduction, the conclusion, all those aspects that makes a story has to be and written in the form of a story, either biographical or autobiographical. Then it is narrative analysis I would use. So the product I will get will be what? Narrative accounts of women. Explanations of how they are coping in the lockdown. Clear? So the type to use will be determined by what you want in the end. This is like I would compare to outcome-based education of UGC. And which NEP talks about, where they are saying, first determine the outcome. What do you want your student to do at the end of the research or at the end of your course, right? Course outcomes, and then backward map it to the process. And then you backward map it from the process of teaching and learning. You go down to evaluation, you go from outcome, evaluation, teaching, learning processes. That's what outcome-based education is all about, and mapping of your COPOs are all about in higher education. Similarly, I would encourage you to think like that for qualitative research methods as well. So it is not what your kind of data determines the kind of thing. It is first that I spent 1 hour in telling you why qualitative research and who should you think yourself to be, what should you think your processes to be, what should you think your students are to be. And then I moved on to understand, tell you two different kinds of method. Again, here I'm moving backward. What do you want from this research? And then determine which kind of method you want to use. After determining this method, do you want, now I'm not stopping here. I'm saying from these different kinds of methods, what do you want these methods to stand singularly? To be accompanying itself with different other methods? And therefore, do you want to do purely qualitative, purely quantitative, purely and mixed method? Go back till you reach which paradigm of research are you subscribing to? Based on the question, friends, you will see your strategy for analysis of data also varies. So in closing, I would say when we think of how to conduct a research, we must think not only of using techniques, but also rightly using the techniques we have used. So it's not about whether you are used correctly, you have given the name of grounded or ethnography or a case study or narrative, but even when I'm doing it, whether I'm rightly using the techniques that I have used. May this be something that we are constantly mindful of as researchers. Yeah. Thank you. And now we would open ourselves to any form of discussion. And if not that, I would like to simultaneously, even or maybe after 2-3 minutes, if I see nothing, just to excite ourselves, I have just put very baby questions, not trying to follow exactly the, taxonomy of blueprint of knowledge, understanding, application, et cetera. But primarily, I thought I would use this quiz at the end. So if you want to take it, you could log in. I will share the link with you for the Google form.
Yeah. Ma'am, there is one question.
Yeah.
Pankaj Shingote has asked that if you could please share some actual good qualitative research papers or maybe links that represents these research designs.
So do you want the links or papers or how is it?
I think he's asking for the links. Maybe he wants to read up.
Read up? Okay.
Yeah. Are you there? You can ask your question.
I can do it. Yeah. What I can do, Usha, is I can send you some good references that I have used, at least 6-7 of them. But remember, these are not in the open source. So if you could, one of you all in the college could be kind enough to put it as a reference. Don't circulate it as an article, though I will send it to you as an article. But since it's not from the open source, if you could just put it in a reference form and give them, and they can Google search and go to that. I think that's the closest we can get.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, the...
yeah, we'll do that.
Yeah, so that's something that Usha, I promised to send you by this evening, but you can still remind me again.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, the link I have put in over here, those of you who want to make a try, there are just simple 10 questions, I think not 10, 14 questions if you would want to take a look at that. Meanwhile, those of you who can do it later also, but if you would want to ask any clarifications, etc., I'm happy to do that.
Participants, if you have questions for ma'am, you can unmute yourself and you may ask the questions. Alternatively, you may also put up the questions in the Zoom chat box as well as in the WhatsApp. So we shall then take these questions for ma'am.
May I?
Yes, yes, Rekha.
Rekha. Ma'am, my topic of research is technology-enhanced formative assessment for self-regulated learning among the secondary students. And for that, I have one objective for that. That is to identify the self-regulated learning indicators. So for that purpose, the content analysis research methodology I wanted to use. So can you please explain, so how long I can go with that in that particular section? This concept is self-regulation is very vast. So to identify that indicators, so how can go with that?
I think the question is very rightly framed, but I'm afraid that I don't have too much of an answer. I could probably only give a suggestion, because how much you need to go in and how far you would like to look into the depth, I think that would be left best to yourself and the guide and the kind of research that you are doing. But nevertheless, I can definitely say that content analysis would be a very useful tool for you to develop the indicators of self-regulation, as well as to, like we said, in the whole aspect of qualitative research, how do we then filter down to the sub-constructs of a particular construct? It would help. Now, the method of construct content analysis, if that's what you are looking for, I think this would be very much the method of qualitative data analysis, as we have seen, which applies the different principles of data analysis, beginning from codes to categories to themes, and what are the constant comparison as a method of a principle of inquiry, etc., would have to be used for the process of content analysis. But I think content analysis would be used to identify the sub-constructs of the theme of self-regulation. But very rightly identified, and I think it sounds so rich.
Yeah.
Be able to use that.
Yes, thank you so much, ma'am.
I hope to see some paper like this soon.
Yes, definitely, ma'am. The Uplane, ma'am, I'm from Savitribai Phule Pune University, and Uplane, ma'am, Megha Uplane, ma'am, is my guide.
Great. So I'm sure she has taken, benefited a lot on her understandings of content analysis. So I think that's exciting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Participants, if you all have any more questions, kindly ask your questions to Sibyl, ma'am?
Ma'am, when we do book review, like critically, when you're doing a critical analysis of a book, so that becomes which type of risk, qualitative research?
See, now that could fall even in terms of content analysis, you could use as a method of qualitative research. You may want to even use that as probably, so, but you're saying only book review, no?
Yes, yes. Means we take a book and we usually make our students do in B.Ed. Like a critically do a, like a textbook when we say in simple language. A simple example, if I would say that critically evaluate the textbook of so-and-so students. So-and-so right. class, I mean to say of so-and-so subject. So that would be, ma'am, would be that be a qualitative?
This as a, use this as a qualitative method for a larger objective.
Okay, okay.
But have something more overarching, but use this as one of the ways to lead to there. Okay. One of the understandings. So I think we need,
Ma'am, there are many experts who do this critically evaluation of a book and they write their comments and all. So will that be also a qualitative research?
Yeah, so that will be content analysis for the, now for example, if you are trying to study a particular theme in that book, or you are wanting to study with regard to a particular book that would give you information about a particular social phenomena.
Okay.
Then this will be, that is considered as a qualitative research to bring about new understanding about this phenomena.
Okay, you take a theme or issue this and then you try and analyze it, it becomes a qualitative. But in general, like we have some books, good books and people, experts who are well-versed with this and they give their comments and they write about it. So that doesn't become a qualitative.
No, that will become a review.
Okay, okay, okay.
So I think the first person we should appreciate who has finished the quiz was Raj. The email ID only, I didn't put the name, but was Rajesh Kasat. Yeah, rajeshkasat2@gmail.com. So thanks. That was the first person who finished submission, following which we have Saira Sabuwala, then Jagruti and JYT Jyoti Rahut, must be JYTRahut@gmail.com. So that I think it's great. And to see at least four of you who have attempted. And I think let's wait for at least five. And then we'll say out of five, probably only one, which we would talk in terms of the highest. So maybe I'm expecting at least two more to attempt this. Okay, anybody else? So we could then get ready to wind up.
Archana ma'am, are there any more questions in the WhatsApp group?
No.
No. Yeah, right. Even I checked, no questions there.
So ma'am, as you said, we'll wait for a couple of minutes for a couple more students to complete attempting the Google form.
Yeah, sure.
Ma'am, there were two questions which had come in the beginning. They're not directly related to the research, but basically it was when you had shared about the first research that was put forth about the addiction. So it was in relation to that this question was asked, what about addiction of mobiles and social media?
What types of?
What about the addiction to mobiles and social media? I think you had referred to the addiction of marijuana.
I think that could also be a very interesting area of study. So remember that this, what they came up, is useful for using it for other types of addiction. But each type of addiction would, again, like qualitative research, bring in its own unique, unique knowledge base into that research as well. Because this was with regard to substance abuse. We have general principles for addictions which we can take from here, but with regard to electronic addictions, with regard to habits of the using habits of the mouth in terms of speech, etc., will bring in different kinds of theories as well, though commonalities would be there. When we're looking at digital, we need to also look at theories which primarily deal with learnings in digital media or using of digital media also.
Thank you, ma'am. There was one more question, ma'am, which was related to, once again, addiction. What percent social status and peer pressure play a role in addiction?
What percent? P-E-R-C-E-N-T?
N-T, yes. Yeah. What percent?
Okay, again, for this, I'd love to adopt the sophisticated epistemological belief that says that, you know, knowledge is not static. Knowledge is evolving and there is no standard answer. So I would quickly cling on to that and say that even with regard to percent as such, it would be not fair for me to comment on a number of thing. It would vary depending even on the social context, the kind of people that they were dealing with, whether India and abroad and within India also with so many kinds of things. So I don't think I would I feel insufficient to answer that question.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. These were two questions that were posed in the beginning. So I thought
nevertheless, repeat that question again, Usha.
Yeah, I'll do that. What percent social status and peer pressure plays a role in addiction?
So I think the question is really genuine, and may I at least leave a question that I think it plays a substantial role. Yeah, and I think that would answer that. It does play an important substance. Yeah, substantial role in determining the kind of addictions one goes.
Okay, ma'am. I think those were all.
Stop. And we'll just quickly, I'd like to then read out maybe. Let me just look. Yeah. So I think we've got the number of people, 17 responses. And so far in the 17 responses, we haven't yet got full, but we have got very close to full. And still we have jytraut@gmail.com as leading very close with 13 out of 15. Yeah, so jytraut substantially leads in the 17, and congratulations to each one of you. And the rest of, if I were to count, the next in the order of those who are closest to this 13 is 12. And there are 8 out of the 17 who are 12. Yeah. So with that, I'm happy. And thank you once again for this opportunity for learning from you and learning with you.
Ma'am, so over to you, Dr. Katkiri.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Usha, ma'am. Ma'am, thank you so much. It was, again, for us also, so much of learning, though we have heard so many times all of these sessions from you, but definitely so many things to take away again today. Ma'am, I would request the PhD scholar, Priya Francis, to please propose the formal vote of thanks.
Yes. Yeah, am I audible? Good afternoon.
Yes, good Priya, afternoon. You are.
Everyone. Yeah. Yeah. On behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, Principal Madam Dr. Anita Swami, the entire HJCE team, and all the participants of Capacity Building Program and Pre-PhD course organized by HJCE Center of Innovation under the aegis of RUSA, I, Priya Francis, am privileged to have received this opportunity to convey our heartfelt gratitude to our vibrant resource person, Dr. Sybil Thomas. in an extremely eloquent manner using several examples, rather relevant. Dr. Sybil, you helped us all to understand qualitative research. The four landmarks that you took us through on this journey today of what is qualitative research, of qualitative data collection methods, of validity and reliability, types or different types of qualitative research design, and an overview of different research has surely given us amazing takeaways in this particular session. Especially the four notions that you mentioned about distinctness, process, closeness, and improved understanding. I think we're still thinking on that, and all of us surely will work and think on these lines to take up qualitative research. This session has been thoroughly engaging and insightful with so many relevant current topics, especially regarding COVID-19 and of course the Syrian war, the Palestine issue also that you took up. It's very important that we think relevant and in the current times. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, we also take this opportunity to salute you for the wonderful and inspiring contribution to the field of education and truly honored by your presence today. Thank you, Sybil, ma'am.
Yeah, so thank you once again to all of you, to Principal Dr. Anita Swami Madam, Usha Madam, and Archana Karuna Ma'am, who are always there at the department. Thank you all of you participants for adding to my joy and my learning.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Sybil Ma'am, entire HJCE team. And thank you for always being with us and associated with us. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Over to you, Karuna ma'am.
Dear participants, one small announcement for pre-PhD course students. So others can definitely exit. All the best, others, those who are doing it as a capacity building program. So please do take care of yourself. Have a nice day ahead and see you all tomorrow. For pre-PhD course, we are sending you assignment number 3. So there were some queries which were sent yesterday quite late as far as sending the email and so that the assignment can be sent. That was sent quite late. So a sincere request that you can always send messages, but please do see the time at what time the messages are to be sent so that we can reply to them. Also, now sending the email and you sending us the assignments. We have already said that we will be sending you the email towards the end, that is on 29th. Why? Because we will provide you the format in a way in which the assignments are to be sent. For example, now there are going to be 5 or 6 assignments. Now, if you send us daily one assignment, so it is going to be a little difficult for us to keep a track of the assignments. So we would love towards the end to send them in one folder. And that we will tell you on 29. So keep on writing down the assignments and keep the assignments with you on 29. We will tell you exactly how to send those assignments and the email ID will also be given on that particular day. Thank you so much once again, Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am. Do you want to add anything regarding assignment?
No, Karuna ma'am, you've added.
May I ask ma'am? So after 29, we'll get some days to work on it.
Yes. Praveen, we have already said that on the very first day that we are definitely going to give you some time for the completion of the assignments. All right? Don't worry about that.
My belief that after we finish attending all the lectures, our understanding will be far better to attempt the assignments rather than attempting right away.
Don't worry. We are sending you the assignments and definitely we'll give you some time. So we are going to give you some time. It is not that on the very first we are sending you the email ID on 29th and we will ask you to submit the assignments by 31st. We are going to give you sufficient time to write down the assignments and then send it across to us. All right? So we will definitely give some time. Is that okay, Praveen?
Yes, ma'am. Thanks for the clarity.
My question is, can we get the PPTs, at least PPTs of the resource person?
Rekha, PPTs usually the resource persons don't share. Because PPTs are their personal you know, that is their personal property. But what we are going to do, I have written down that in the WhatsApp group also, that towards the end, give us some time, because we upload the recording of every session on our YouTube channel. And
thank you so much.
And the link of that will be shared with all of you in our WhatsApp group. So you will get access to all the recordings, but towards the end.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay. So I think then we are through.
And Karuna, ma'am. I would just like to thank Priya for the vote of thanks. Because Sybil ma'am started immediately, I just couldn't say that. Priya, thank you for the vote of thanks, for proposing the vote of thanks.
Thank you, ma'am, for this opportunity.
Over to you, Karuna, ma'am.
All right. So feedback form we will be definitely sending immediately after we end up the meeting. But one thing keep in mind, your attendance is being monitored on daily basis. And feedback form, filling up of feedback form is must. All right. Now, if you are not doing pre-PhD course, you will get the certificate of capacity building program that you have attended it as a capacity building program participant. All right. But yes, for that also feedback form is must. So please see to it that you fill up the feedback form. With that,
Karuna ma'am, 1 minute for the feedback form. Since yesterday I observed that, and I would just like to tell participants, yes, please fill it before 8 p.m. If you later send a personal request that you forgot to fill the form, and then kindly allow us to fill it, it becomes very difficult for us to every time open the link, keep it active, and even to keep a record. So requesting, we are giving you sufficient time. It is just 1:30. So we give you more than 7.5 hours to fill the feedback form, which actually just takes 5 minutes. So please do it before 8. We will not be opening the link again. Okay, I hope you all just keep that in mind. It's a request to you all participants. Yes, Karuna ma'am. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay, Usha ma'am, should we wind up then?
Excuse me, ma'am. Atmaja here.
Yes, Atmaja.
Ma'am, as per that flyer, tomorrow we don't have the session.
No, tomorrow it is not. Tomorrow it is not there. We are again going to have 27, 28 and 29.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you.
Usha, ma'am?
Yes, Karuna, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Participants, thank you so much. Take care of yourself. Stay safe and stay healthy. See you on 27. So I am ending up.